Thank you for joining us. This meeting is being recorded, we're being reminded. So this is the Goldcrest Brook Feasibility and Implementation Workshop. This is gonna be the first of two workshops, and we're gonna help you understand what you're here for today, what we're gonna be talking about, and what you can expect from this meeting. But first, we'll do a quick round of introductions. I'll introduce myself, hand it over to the folks from the city to introduce themselves, and then back to our team from ESA. So my name is Steve Roloff. I'm a landscape architect and landscape ecologist with Environmental Science Associates. We go by the name ESA. And we are working with the city on the Goldcrest Brook remediation plan. And I'm going to hand it over to Ben to start the introductions. We have some city staff with us here this evening.
Yeah, thank you. So my name is Ben Haney. I'm an engineer and a project manager with the City of Salem Public Works. And maybe I'll hand it off to Anita here.
Thing. Anita Panko, I'm the stormwater quality supervisor, and our work group does a lot of work in the streams. And I'll go ahead and hand it off to Peter.
My name is Peter Dalrymple. I'm with the City of Salem Stormwater Quality Monitoring Group. I am the program coordinator, and I work under Anita and have been involved with Goldcrest Brook for some time now.
Thank you. All right, Brian.
I'm Brian Taylor. I'm a water resources engineer with ESA. On this project, I'm also our team's project manager, and I'll be leading the engineering assessment that we're going to be talking about here a little later.
And Sarah.
Good evening, I'm Sarah Hartung. I'm a permit specialist and a wetlands and wildlife ecologist. I'll be working with the team, Steve, Brian, the city, on likely permit pathways for different stream solutions.
Great, thank you, Sarah. All right, so this evening we're gonna have a somewhat brief presentation. Ben's gonna help us understand where we are in the project timeline. Brian and I are gonna go through an initial assessment of the watershed and the existing conditions of the creek. And so that we're all on the same page with our understanding of Goldcrest Brook and some of the issues there. And then we're gonna get into the meat of the workshop, and we have some questions for you. So we're very eager to hear from folks who live along the creek, who have an interest in Goldcrest Brook. So we're gonna try to frame this all out for you. And then we've got four important questions. We'd like to hear from everyone who's comfortable answering those questions. We'd love to hear from you. And then at the end, we will have an open session where you can ask the city or our team, ESA's team, any kind of questions you'd like in regard to this project. Along the way, if you have pressing questions or you want to jump in, please feel free to just unmute yourself. You can actually raise your hand and ask a question. You can use the raise hand function on Zoom, or there is a chat box that Rose is going to be monitoring, and she'll let us know. Sometimes when we're presenting, it's a little hard to see what's happening with the chat box and whatnot. But if we're going along and something comes up in your mind, you have a pressing question, just unmute yourself and ask the question. This is a fairly informal meeting. But again, at the end of the meeting, we're gonna have plenty of time for questions too. So if you'd prefer to just kind of hold your questions till the end, that's great too. We really appreciate all of your time being here today. We know you're busy, and this is a beautiful summer evening, but we also know that Goldcrest Brook is a very important resource in West Salem. And because it affects many of your properties, you wanna know what the next steps are and what kind of plans we're working on. So with that, I'm going to start a presentation and get us started. And Ben is gonna help frame where we are in the project timeline. So let me go ahead and share my screen. All All right. Can everybody see that? Ben, can you give me a thumbs up that you see that?
Yep, I see it.
Great. So again, this is the Goldcrest Brook Restoration Feasibility and Implementation Workshop. We're building off the studies of a previous firm, West Consultants. And I will jump forward here. And Ben is going to give us a project overview and timeline.
Sure. Yeah, once again, just want to thank everybody for making time tonight. I know it's a beautiful evening, and probably sitting in front of your computer and phone is not what you might rather be doing right now, but I do appreciate everyone's time here tonight, and we're looking forward to get some feedback from the folks. And again, my name is Ben Haney. I'm a engineer and project manager with the City of Salem Public Works, and I am the project manager on the Goldcrest Brook project. And before we get too much in depth, like Steve said, I just want to take a few minutes to get you up to speed on the general project and timeline and how what we're doing here tonight fits into that. So this implementation plan is part of our larger project to improve Goldcrest Brook. The objectives of that project are to address erosion, improve stream function, and improve habitat within the riparian area. This implementation and feasibility plan is to develop a comprehensive plan for improvements both along the creek and within the watershed that will allow us to meet those objectives and then proceed with funding, design, permitting, and construction. So it's kind of a holistic plan of improvements that allows us to get to that point, move forward. Go ahead, next slide, Steve, if you don't mind. So this plan builds upon the work completed last year by the city and West Consultants to model the watershed. So this modeling that was done last year is the basis for evaluating and selecting improvements for implementation. The other thing West Consultants did with their effort last year was identify the effectiveness of various mitigation strategies or tools, which gives us a toolbox to start from when we're developing this holistic plan of improvements. So for example, these tools include adding or modifying upstream stormwater detention ponds and basins, adding small check dams along the creek, disconnecting roof downspouts from direct discharge into the creek, and several other stream and watershed improvements. Okay, Steve? So the city, after completion of that West evaluation, the city has hired ESA to build on the work completed by West and to develop a holistic plan based on the modeling and tools identified by West Consultants. So what I mean by developing a holistic plan is developing a plan of improvements within the watershed and along the creek with considerations for a lot of the real world items that need to be considered when we're talking about these sorts of public improvements. And that includes federal, state, and local permit requirements, which is a big consideration when we're working along in creeks and streams. The ability to construct in tight areas with limited access. Once again, a very big consideration when we're looking at potential improvements along the creek within people's backyards. And another big consideration, which is property owner acceptance and enthusiasm. And Steve will talk a lot more about that and how that fits in here, but you know, we really want to look at potential improvements that may be in people's backyards and make sure that those are improvements that people are going to be enthusiastic about having in their backyards, accepting of having in their backyards. And then also incorporating environmental and ecological benefits where we can. And then, you know, of course, funding. So looking at the cost of improvements and the funding availability and the funding options, and considering that when we're coming up with this holistic plan.
Hey, Ben.
Yeah.
Ken Byerly has raised his hand. I believe he has a question.
Oh, sure. Go ahead.
Yeah, the question is, was the West consultant's work what was summarized by Peter Dalrymple about a year ago?
Yeah, I believe there was a workshop, another virtual workshop, I believe it was last October. Peter and Anita, is that correct?
Sorry, I was trying to unmute myself there. We did have a workshop, I believe it was last October, and then I did provide a presentation to the Glen Gibson Watershed Council, which would have been just before West had finished their study and come to their conclusions.
Thank you. I was trying to put that presentation in context. Thank you.
Sure.
You're welcome.
And Steve, I'm ready for the next slide if there's no more questions at this point. Okay. So just kind of the overall view of the project and where this is going and how we fit into this. So in 2020 was the West evaluation. We're moving that forward to an implementation plan. So from that plan, as I described, what we are going to come out with a specific recommendation for specific improvements along the creek and within the watershed. Now, those improvements are likely going to fall into two buckets. One is smaller, lower cost measures. We have some funding available now to move forward with those. And our intent would be to move right into design and permitting for those measures that we could get permitted and funded for construction in 2022. And then there's a bucket of larger, higher cost improvements. And those are items that would need to go program for consideration into our capital improvement program for funding, go through a prioritization process for funding, and then proceed to design and permitting and construction. And those, at the earliest, we would be looking at construction in 2023 and potentially beyond, depending on the cost of improvements, the number of improvements, and how those are prioritized against other stormwater utility needs. So with that, I'll go ahead and turn it back over to Steve, but I'm happy to maybe stop and see if there's any other questions before we continue. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Ben. So the purpose of today's meeting, just so we can frame what we're all here for, and again, we're really thankful that you're here tonight, and we're excited to be here as well. So we're going to review the existing conditions of the creek with the folks who are attending the meeting. We're going to gather feedback from you that specifically is going to inform our feasibility study. So that's the big crux here. We want some feedback from neighbors that helps inform our feasibility study. We're going to provide a venue for questions, both that we are questions for you and questions from you back to the team. And then just wanted to let you know, looking ahead, there is going to be a workshop number two this fall where we're going to present more about our draft remediation plan. So right now we're just looking at the feasibility of specific improvements that might be able to happen along the creek and in the watershed. But the remediation plan is going to be more specific about which specific improvements and where would they occur in the landscape. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Brian Taylor. And he's going to give us an overview of the watershed and some of the issues that we see along the creek.
Thanks, Steve. next slide. Here we go. So this is a image that, excuse me. The black outline you see is the extent of the watershed for Goldcrest Brook. On this image, Goldcrest Brook is the blue line that's Its headwaters are off to the left side of the screen, which is west, and the creek flows to the east, where it joins with Glen Creek. So this watershed is about 193 acres, and it's about 61% single-family residential housing. It's about 41% hard surfaces. So this would be pavement and sidewalks that when it rains, water is going to run right off. The creek itself is about 3,500 linear feet. And about half of that has had different types of issues with, moderate to severe erosion and channel incision. And incision is the term we use when a creek is cutting downward and getting deeper and deeper into the landscape there. The other thing that this image shows us is the extent of the piping that carries the stormwater when it rains down to the creek. So that's what the red lines are. And then there's a few other stormwater management facilities that are shown in gold. So you get a sense of which way the water's moving here. And of course you can see, we'll zoom in a little later and you can see more, but it's a fairly dense watershed, and the density of the houses along the creek is one of the things that makes improving Goldcrest Brook a little challenging. Next slide, please. So this is another image showing you the extent of the watershed. This one we've kind of flipped around now. If you notice the north arrow at the top, we're kind of looking towards the southwest here. And it's showing you the same basin extents, but you can get a sense the way that we're angled here as far as the steepness and sort of the lay of the land. And you can also get a sense of where there is green space within the watershed and where there's the developed areas. So that's what this is showing us here. So now we're gonna move to looking at some existing conditions in the creek and some of the problems that we're aware of out there that most of you are probably aware of, but we'll just get on the same page like Steve said before. Next. So a pretty common situation is the issues of incision and erosion. And so if you look at the image on the left, you can see what we would call bank erosion. And this is where the force of the water rapidly moving and lack of roughness and things like that have caused banks to get undercut. This is a condition found throughout the corridor. The image on the right, you can also see, you kind of see the channel incision where it's been down cutting, the banks have become vertical, and that leads to things like trees falling over and landing in the creek.
Brian?
Yes.
We have a hand raised. Linda has her hand up.
All right, Linda, what's your question?
Could you go back one slide, please? Yeah, I was curious what the gold areas are.
The gold areas are different types of stormwater facilities that are out within the watershed. So these would be like a detention pond or maybe an underground tank, things like that. So these are the areas where right now rainwater is being slowed down somewhat before it's released into the creek. But what you will notice, I mean, there's a lot of this watershed that is areas that are not served by these kind of facilities.
Specifically, I was interested in the large one on the bottom of the picture.
And that one.
That is at Harrod Elementary School. That's a large detention basin there.
Okay, thank you. That's great. I was just curious.
Yeah, that's definitely the school complex. You can see the outline of the school there. And then a lot of times with schools, you'll maybe use an athletic field or something like that to store water. So that kind of scenario going on.
Yeah, okay. You're right, Brian. I think that is some sort of athletic field.
Mm-hmm. So don't go playing ball during the 100-year storm. It might get your feet wet. Okay. So we can see the erosion challenge here, and I imagine some of you have seen this in your own backyard, probably. Next slide, please. This is kind of illustrating what happens when a watershed develops. You know, most of these areas historically were forest, and so the floor of a forest acts like a sponge when it rains. as that land use changes and those conditions change, there's less and less places for water to go when it rains. So the soil and the forest litter zone isn't absorbing as much. So you get more flow in a creek channel. And these creek channels have evolved to handle a certain amount of flow and be stable. And so lots of times with urbanization, as a watershed paves, as things get plumbed, you'll start to see the creeks start to downcut. And when that happens, the banks will start to fail oftentimes because they just it gets too deep, they're too vertical. And so then the banks will collapse. And then that leads to the whole thing starting to widen. And so that's what this picture is kind of showing us on the left. You can see sort of two snapshots in time as that would be happening. And on the right is sort of a visual example of a bank failure situation where the bank has collapsed. Sometimes you can also see just by looking at the trees, they'll be angled or they'll start to be pistol butted. And that's a sign that you're having bank movement. Next slide, please. Another issue observed in the stream here is what we call head cutting. So head cutting is where you get a spot that is, you know, a little weaker than the rest of the channel and it starts to erode and then things can potentially just unravel. These head cuts often will start to get deeper and deeper, and then they start to work their way upstream is what happens. So the one on the left was sort of an earth. The one on the right was showing where there had been a sewer encasement, you know, pretty common practice, put a sewer, protect it with concrete. But that concrete, when the stream finds it, it has a different smoothness. And so water speeds up and it can start to chew a hole in the stream bed downstream, which is what happened in this case. Next slide. And again, just kind of on that same point here, you can see more visually how this head cut, how they want to move upstream. And they're an indicator that the stream is out of equilibrium. And this goes back to what I was saying before. Streams typically evolve to have a certain steepness and a certain size, width, and depth that sort of matches the amount of water going into it. So when a watershed develops and is urbanized, forests are replaced with hardscape and lawns, there's more water and the stream tries to adjust. And in doing so, you know, hopefully you have space for that to happen, but lots of times you don't, and that starts to create problems. Additionally, you know, the material that's being washed out, it's going somewhere. So depending on what's downstream, that can lead to different things like the sediment will accumulate, which starts to reduce the capacity. If you have any kind of salmon gravels downstream, you don't want to smother them with sediment that's eroded and so forth. So the head cutting is indicative of a stream that's out of whack, out of equilibrium, and is trying to adjust itself. Next slide, please. And as this has happened at Goldcrest Brook, it has exposed different sewer pipes. When this neighborhood was built, some of the sewer laterals, which are the connections from a house out to the main sewer line in the street. But the way that this area was plumbed, some of these crossed the stream itself. When you get exposed sewer lines, that has several levels of risk to it. It could lead to failure of the sewer pipe. It could lead to a leak. It could let stream water into the sewer. It could let sewer water into the stream. So when you see exposed sewers, you really want to remedy that as kind of urgently. Next slide. So another thing that happens when a stream starts to cut itself deeper is that it's not, you know, when the floodwaters come, when the big storms come, it's a lot harder for that water to get deep enough to then spread out and slow itself down. And so that becomes a problem because it sort of is a feedback loop where now you've lost your floodplain storage because the water is stuck down in this trench kind of situation. And so that can have further impacts downstream because now the stream flows have less chance to be slowed down. Next slide, please. Another scenario we see at Goldcrest Brook is where there have been encroachments into the stream channel. So where the stream might have needed a certain width to work hydraulically and be stable, when there's fill put down right next to it, it gets tighter and tighter. Water doesn't have as many places to spread out, so it wants to cut down. And that's what can lead to head cutting and bank erosion and destabilization. Now, next slide. I'll turn it back to you, Steve.
Great, thank you, Brian. Another observation along Goldcrest Brook is, in general, a lot of non-native vegetation. So what we're not seeing are the robust native Pacific Northwest shrubs and ground cover and small trees. Of course, there are some native plants along the corridor, but a lot of what we see are things like English ivy and Armenian blackberry. And the concern with some of the non-native plants is that their rooting structure is not as deep and aggressive as some of the native riparian shrubs. So while we can't blame the channel instability and erosion on the vegetation plays an important role in part of that degrading system. So these are just, you know, this is just one more of the clues we're picking up on little things that are creating this bigger problem. So on the image on the left, you see quite a bit of English ivy, just right down into the creek channel. And on the image on the right, Armenian blackberry, and quite a bit of horsetail. Horsetail's native, but it's not one of the more robust riparian plants that helps stabilize banks in higher flow conditions. So now we're going to briefly go through some potential improvements, building on West's report, and just putting some images to some potential fixes that we see for the riparian corridor. And again, we're assessing the feasibility of these types of fixes here in the first phase of our project. So Brian, I'll turn it back over to you to talk about some of the potential improvements.
Great. Thanks, Steve. The first thing that we noticed out there is there's a lot of areas of the creek that really don't have any kind of gravels or cobbles or anything like that on the bottom. So the creek really doesn't have there are places where it doesn't have any armoring to resist the hydraulic forces that want to carve a deeper channel. So these slides are just showing the kind of materials that would help to stabilize that, and that we envision finding strategic locations where we want to start to restore cobbles and gravels. Gravels are smaller, cobbles are bigger. That's the only difference, really. These are generally fairly rounded kind of stream riparian materials. So the one on the left is just showing you an example of the rain, how these come in a range. That's very typical in a stream that you find stones, rock of different sizes. And then an example on the right is where there's been some restoration work to place some of these into a stream to help stabilize it. Next slide. And one of the recommendations that West made was to use grade controls. So grade controls are generally large rock or other features. They don't have to be rock, but it creates a hardened point in the stream channel that it's going to be really hard for the stream to wash out or to cut deeper than. And so you start to restrict the stream's ability to continue down cutting. And sometimes these will stick up above the bottom of the stream, but you expect that over time it's going to fill in behind them. So the examples here on the left, you can see this is a restoration project. You can still see some of the matting on the banks there. And you can see sort of the finished look after several grade controls are installed. And again, that's going to really fix the stream elevation. It controls the slope and the gradient, which is what drives a lot of the erosive forces. And the example on the right is, it's obviously a bigger stream than Goldcrest Brook is, but it illustrates the point again that these would be spaced out periodically. And you look at the spacing and the heights of them, and you look at that with your engineering and your hydraulic analysis and that's part of what you design for. And it, again, the goal is that you're controlling how fast water can move down there and how much energy it has. Next slide. So the last two I showed you are sort of these discrete broad bands. What you often see if you go up in the mountains around here and steeper hills and the foothills is more of a cascade structure. So there are larger rocks out there that are holding the grade of the stream and keeping it from down cutting, but they might not be quite as regular. And you know, the last two images I showed were sort of unnatural looking. I think you all can probably agree that this, you know, what the drawing on the bottom is showing, it's a plan view kind of showing how You can arrange boulders and whatnot to have a more natural configuration to it. And this kind of approach is something that works pretty well in an incised, you know, channel that's in sort of a narrow canyon. So this is something we're definitely interested to see if it will be feasible for Goldcrest Brook. Next. And because the stream is already down cut, it would be beneficial to be able to raise the stream elevation somewhat, especially where, you know, we have these steep banks. When I was out and we walked it a couple weeks ago, or I guess it was in May, you know, there were some areas even around the top of the banks, you could start to see cracks, and that's an indicator that that bank is starting to lose its stability. And so a lot of times when a bank loses its stability, it kind of fails at the bottom. And so if you can build up a stream bed, it gives it more buttressing there to keep the bank together. It makes it easier when you put in vegetation for the roots to get established and start to tie things back together. So the example on the left is really a stream that has been restored. It was down cut in size, and different types of rock features were put in, and rock was imported to raise the grade and get it to a stable slope that's in equilibrium, so it's not down cutting or changing form. The example on the right is something that people have been experimenting with more in recent years, and it's called a beaver dam analog. And many of you probably know that beavers in a natural environment, they help shape the landscape because they build these beaver dams, and then materials settle behind it so that it flattens out streams and it controls the energy. And so there, we're interested in whether we would be able to use different types of woody materials to create an area that with a source of gravels upstream of it, would be able to start to collect gravels and start to fill that channel back in using a sort of natural process. So it's a beaver dam analog because we're not talking about putting beavers out there. We're talking about a crew of workers building something like this that'll act like a beaver dam. Next slide. And with bank stabilization, there's different ways to do it. This slide is showing what is called a bioengineering approach. And on the left, it's a section view. So it's like you cut through the bank and you're looking at kind of end on. And what you see there is there's different words for it. You would call it soil lifts or fabric encapsulated soil. But the idea is that you take a layer of soil and you wrap a coir fabric, some kind of biodegradable fabric. Coir is coconut fiber, and it's really strong and resistant to decay, and that's why it's used a lot in restoration work. You wrap it in between, you can lay brush layers of live plant material that'll grow and start to reestablish plants with roots back in the bank to hold things together. So from the image on the left that shows the layering and how this would be built up in layers, these are generally like a foot to 18 inches high. On the right, you see one actually being built. And you can see that they have about three layers built there and they're laying in the brush. And you can also see that this is in a fairly tight urban setting. So this is something that could potentially be used at Goldcrest Brook. Next slide, please. Next, there we go. So another idea, so those were talking about sort of the creek side, but we're also interested in where the water is coming from and opportunities throughout the watershed to control how much water reaches the creek and how quickly it reaches the creek. If we can slow it down or let some of it soak into the ground away from the creek, that helps a lot to start to get the landscape to act more like the forest that it was when Goldcrest Brook sort of originally evolved. So these are called rain gardens. And the context here is that, you know, a lot of the homes in the neighborhood have their rain spouts going directly out to the creek. And so from the time a drop of water hits the roof, I mean, it's just shooting out to the creek within 30 seconds, lots of times, I bet. You know, it doesn't really have a chance to slow down or get absorbed or anything like that. And so, you know, we've all seen, you know, where somebody will have a downspout with a splash block that just spreads it out in the yard. And that's one way you can disconnect it. But another way is you can make a really pretty aesthetic, cool landscape feature and called a rain garden. And so you would take your rainwater from your roof and you would send it to an area, sort of a sunken part of the landscape that's landscaped with the right kind of plants that can withstand the amount of water you'd be sending there. And, you know, ideally you use native plants, but it's not always required. And this gives the water a place to go. It gives a chance for it to get filtered and to go back into the ground to feed the groundwater. And it keeps it from going directly into the stream. Next slide, please. So another concept we're looking at within the watershed is, there's two concepts here on this slide. The one on the left would be potentially rerouting some storm pipes. There's some opportunity to take pipes that dump water up towards the top of the stream reach, towards the headwaters, and maybe send it a little bit farther downstream. And that would relieve some of the pressure on that upper reach where there is some pretty serious erosion issues going on. The other thing with that concept is that if we can use if we can enhance the functioning of existing stormwater facilities. So on Ammon Street, there's an existing stormwater basin there. It's sunken down a few feet below the rest of the grade around it. And it has, you know, water can get into it and out of it. There's a pipe and there's a manhole in there that has a restrictor. So a restrictor is basically something that goes in the end of a pipe and has a little tiny hole. So it's like, it would be like if you took your bathtub drain and you covered it half up so the water couldn't move out as fast. So when you send water in, it's going to stay there and then slowly be released. So we think that we can improve the functioning of the existing facilities so that they really leverage the available storage within them and are filling up as much as they can, you know, and then also by sending, you know, looking at rerouting to get even more water into these, we can improve the amount of slowing down that happens with the stormwater in the piped collection system. And I'm gonna turn it back to Steve for our next slide.
Great, thank you, Brian. So Brian talked about rain gardens. There are some different terminologies used. I typically think of rain gardens as occurring on private property. Stormwater planters are often in the public right of way, so within the roads. And there are a number of neighborhood streets in the area that the rainwater off of those streets goes into catch basins and discharges directly into Goldcrest Brook. One potential opportunity is to retrofit, to install stormwater planters on the edges of some of those roadways. And we'll show you a couple examples here. So a stormwater planter often is created by taking the curb line and bumping it out into the parking zone. So it does take up a parking stall or two. But behind that curb is essentially a basin that stores water. So the rainwater is routed into that basin. You can see on the image on the right, a section cut through one of these basins. They're often a couple feet deep. They have a special highly permeable soil mixture in them. And the idea is that when during a rainstorm, water first flows into these basins. These basins are storing some of the stormwater flow. If all things are working well, they're also infiltrating some of that water into the soil below the basin. And if there's a very large storm event, there's always overflows on these, either back out onto the street into a storm drain, or there's an outlet structure that's in the planter itself that is plumbed into the storm system. Here's two photos of some very simple retrofit stormwater planters in the right of way. These are planted very simply with some rushes. They can be planted with more ornamental plants. Sometimes you can squeeze trees into them. And not only do they help absorb and slow the flow of stormwater, but they also have some other objectives, which are nice in neighborhoods. They tend to slow down traffic a little bit on wide neighborhood streets. They give the drivers the feeling that the road is a little narrower. And then along with that, along the streetscape are street trees. So in the neighborhood surrounding Goldcrest Brook, there's lots of amazing trees, but we do see some opportunity to strategically try to get some more tree canopy directly over some of the larger roadways. And when the trees have leaves in the spring, summer, and fall, they actually do a really good job intercepting, especially small rain events. And so they're one more tool in the long term to help intercept the rainwater before it goes into Goldcrest Brook. So just another tool in the toolkit that all adds together to reduce the load of water on the creek itself. And street trees also have other, they bring other benefits to the neighborhood, of course. They help shade the streets and cool things down. They also help tend to slow down drivers and can increase property values. And then another, we had mentioned the generally degraded riparian vegetation condition along portions of Goldcrest Brook currently. We see real opportunity for a thoughtful and deliberate revegetation approach along the stream corridor, focusing on robust native shrubs, maybe some small trees and other aggressive native ground cover species. This would be, again, a more of a long-term approach as the banks are being stabilized and some of those other channel features that Brian described have been implemented and the stream is starting to not downcut and erode as aggressively. You get in there and replant a lot of native vegetation, and that's one more tool in the toolkit that's helping hold that whole system together and helping it be more resilient to periodic flood events. All right, so finally, construction constraints. So we've talked about a lot of ideas for what we might be able to do along the creek, but there are some realities of getting in and working on the creek. As easy as it would be to bring a dump truck full of gravel and dump it into the creek channel and let the creek sort it out, we don't necessarily have that opportunity here. So here is an aerial photograph. Some of you may recognize your houses in here. This is Goldcrest Brook flowing from the bottom left to the top right, where it emerges from the storm sewer system and is daylit. And what you see here are a lot of houses that in some cases are very close together. There's a lot of fences, a lot of really nice trees, driveways, other built features that really limit the ability to make big moves with big equipment along this creek corridor. So we're having to think about some different ideas. How would you implement some of these improvements on the creek corridor? Brian?
Yeah, so, you know, as we're brainstorming this is just kind of show you some things that are done in different places. On the left is a small conveyor system. You can see that this is something that was brought in. It sets up pretty quick, and these can range from, you know, 3 to 6 feet wide. And it gives you the ability to have, they move materials basically from out in the street to back into the backyard, as it were, and down into the creek. So you can see here how this one's set up. It's going right through that gate. So it looks like there's a mini excavator in the backyard there, the one on the left. And so the image on the right is then showing too that there might be places we can get mini excavators in. These come in a lot of different configurations, but there are some of them that the tracks actually can suck in so that they can get through gates and narrow passages, and then they can move back out when they're at their destination to be a little more stable. So we feel like all these ideas are on the table, and to make our recommendations something that can really be built without messing up people's yards, we have to look at some of these creative construction techniques too. I think that's about all I have on that at this time, Steve.
Great, thank you, Brian. All right, so we appreciate everyone making their way through the presentation. We're done talking now. You've probably heard enough from us. We have some questions for you, and we would love to get some feedback. We've got 4 questions. I think there's enough time that we can have everybody have an opportunity if you're comfortable and if you have an answer for these questions. We'd love to have you chime in. Let me jump to the next slide. So we'll go one by one, but let me give you a preview of the question. The first question is, what are your biggest concerns with the current condition of the creek? We saw what we saw out there, but we would love to see, we'd love to hear from you about what you're seeing on the creek. The second question, we'd like to know what observations you've made about how the stream has changed since you've moved into your house. We're seeing the stream in a snapshot in time right now, but what's also very important for us to understand is the trajectory of change that's been occurring on this creek. So any insights you have on that, that would be awesome. The third question, what outcomes do you hope to see from this project? We really want to make sure we're not going down a certain pathway that's not supported by the neighbors. So we want to know what outcomes you hope to see from this project. And then finally, we'll ask, and this is not a commitment in any way right now, but would you be willing to allow construction access through your property? And again, we're not looking for firm commitments. It's just, if you're kind of like, yeah, I'd consider that, or no, I'd prefer not. We're just trying to get a feel for the overall take on that. So I'm going to stop sharing the screen and we're going to go around and have everyone share what their biggest concerns are with the current condition of the creek.
Hey, Steve.
Yes.
There's a message in the chat from Richard McLaughlin.
Great. Okay, Richard says we're at 1504 Ammon and our next door neighbor's sewer pipe, which ran under the stream, slumped and plugged up. It cost them $25,000 to repair by pumping sewage up the line in the center of the street. Are all of us on this lower side going to have to incur this expense? And he also shares that our patio and side yard are too built up for machinery, but a conveyor belt would be okay. Awesome. Thank you, Richard. So let's see, the sewer pipe onto the creek, slumped and plugged up, cost $25,000 to repair by pumping sewage up into the line in the center of Ammon Street. So,
yeah, and I can chime in here, Steve.
Great.
So our goal is no. And that's one of the other, just another reason why we are excited about moving this project forward. I think if this, creek condition continues unabated, we're going to see more and more of those. I would expect our plan, of improvements would be something where we are abating that erosion and allowing, getting those existing sewer lateral crossings restabilized and allowing those crossings to continue in a way where they're protected from future erosion. So I had heard a little bit about this situation, I think, when we were out there talking to some folks. We would not embark on a plan that part of our plan was to come to every property owner along there and say, oh, you're on the hook now to reroute a sewer lateral. What we would do is try to prevent that situation from occurring in the future and get those sewer laterals stabilized and prevent future erosion from undermining them further.
Thank you, Ben. So who else has, would like to share about their biggest concerns with the current condition of the creek? That of course, that was a big concern. That's a really important topic. Feel free to type your questions in the chat, or if you'd like to unmute yourself and just ask the question, that is great too. Okay. Oh, let's see, we got, E.M. Easterly has a question. What steps will be needed to stabilize the creek at the outfall of the stormwater pipe system, the headwater point?
Well, I think that, one thing to recognize is that there's different places that stormwater enters this system. And so they each, these locations tend to have different conditions right now. So it's going to depend. I mean, reducing the flow is part of our strategy that we're going to be looking at for sure. and otherwise looking at restoring the creek's ability to handle the flow where it comes out of the pipe. So when flow comes out of a pipe, it tends to have a lot of energy. Sometimes it's plunging down a couple feet till it hits the stream bed bottom. So we're certainly aware and saw some places that that was causing an erosion problem of itself. And so that's the type of situation we're gonna be looking at with our feasibility study. So we're certainly looking at it, but we haven't come to a conclusion about what that answer would be right now. It might be putting in rock, it might be putting in some different kind of energy dissipation system.
Sarah Campos has her hand up.
May I just jump in with a follow-up question for EM real fast? I was curious if you're referring to that where the stream daylights or just at any outfall along the stream.
Peter, I was specifically talking about where the stream daylights, because that's the beginning of the major impact upon this historical stream.
Mm-hmm. And in fact, the conditions that I've seen on site so far, that stream section of stream is actually fairly well protected with some existing cobble that is either natural to the system or that has been placed by the, you know, builders of the homes or the homeowners. We don't really know the history of that, but there is significant cobble there that has, at least up until now, protected that area. There is a head cut lower than that that could be stabilized to improve protection for that area. Perhaps Brian or Steve could speak to that a little bit more.
Well, that matches my observation too. There's a second outfall that's some feet, maybe 150 feet downstream, that seems to be where the erosion really starts to pick up. So we'll be sort of assessing how much of a role going the whole way to the very top outfall would, you know, how much would be required and what benefits that would bring versus kind of looking at that next one down. As you can imagine too, the sort of the severity of impacts that happens from these outfalls depends on how much area they capture. And that's kind of where it goes back to that watershed map of all the different pipes and us, you know, comparing the situations there.
Great. Sarah, I think you were next.
Yeah, hi, I live along the creek and I was gonna answer the question. I think it was, what are we most afraid of? Or can you remind me what it was?
What's your biggest concern with the current condition of the creek corridor?
Just erosion of my property. Some of my neighbors have lost several feet of their property. And I don't want to see that continue for me or anybody else.
Great, thank you, Sarah. So in the chat, we have a question. Oh, was someone trying to go ahead? Is that Shelley?
Yes.
Please go ahead.
Oh, I was just.
I'm sorry, are you there? I didn't hear your question.
Oh, I didn't have a question.
Oh, okay.
I think Shelly was just joining.
Oh, great. So okay.
I just got back from vacation. It's kind of crazy.
Okay.
Sorry.
We have a couple more questions coming in the chat. Linda is asking, if the detention facility on Ammon is retrofitted, will it include water quality as well as capacity? Brian, do you want to take that one?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think that what we're going to look at with the feasibility study we're doing here is we're going to look at how feasible it would be to do that, right? And we're certainly targeting first sort of the quantity flow aspect of it, because that's where the creek is impacted sort of structurally. But I think, you know, anywhere we can provide a water quality benefit, we're interested in doing that. So we mentioned the stormwater planner type approach, and that's something that those, you know, clearly provides a lot of filtering. That Ammon basin that we had the picture of, you know, that's a vegetated basin. So once we get water more expressing into that, it'll have more chance to infiltrate, which removes pollutants from the stream, and you get some vegetative uptake as well. And we'll work with the state to see how much they want to integrate that as well.
Thank you, Brian.
I guess I would just add on to that even just the act of storing and detaining that water, while not technically a water quality facility, should provide some benefit in terms of settling of suspended solids.
Right. And a lot of the contaminants, pollutants that we think of, you know, that affect like, fish and whatnot, they tend to stick to the solids. So if you can get settling of the particulates, you do a lot for water quality right there. You know, you knock down your copper, your zinc, and a lot of the stuff that comes off the road is going to want to stick to the solids and promoting settling wherever we can with the stormwater type improvements is something that would fit into sort of our feasibility study that we're doing and would help us to weigh pros and cons of different approaches.
Great. Okay, a couple more questions. Ken Beerley has a good question. How much benefit would there be to increase storage in the upper portion of the watershed? For example, Orchard Heights Reservoir site appears to potentially be reconfigured to store significant water.
That's, we're looking at the existing facilities for sure. That's something that in the West study, they looked at it with hydraulic models and stormwater models. And so they have recommendations about ways to change the outlet structures so that you can get more use out of those facilities on the types. So you can store more water for the kinds of storm events that are shaping the channel. So I don't have too much specifics about that particular site to offer you right now, but it's certainly in the mix.
I could speak briefly to that site on Orchard Heights. It does not collect a ton of runoff there in that portion of the watershed. So we could add something there, but it likely would not have a huge impact on the total flow into the basin.
Would it be possible to reconfigure the storm drainage system so it would have more flow? And then you can store that flow and release it at a metered rate.
Ken, there is a piped detention facility on Orchard Heights, which might provide some additional capacity. I'm just speaking from my mental image right now, but I do believe that at the reservoir there, that collects runoff just from that Orchard Heights reservoir site. And so that's actually downslope of the larger piped detention facility, and it would be difficult to route water into that except for what it captures already on site there.
Okay.
Yeah, and I just want to chime in. I think that's a great idea, and yeah, those are the types of things that we'll be looking at specifically. Just looking at Orchard Heights, that's got a big open area. I think the topography might be a little bit of a challenge, but you know, that's one of the goals of this study, is to look at these types of potential opportunities and chase them down a little bit and see, you know, what could work with kind of some of the existing assets we have, and with one being the land out at Orchard Heights that the city owns, and those types of opportunities.
And there is an open channel.
You know, the city has already invested
that property
with the West study of putting together these hydraulic models. So we do have tools available to look at these where we can get the water to go the right direction and can conceive of repiping things. We have the ability to pretty efficiently get that into a model to see how beneficial that would be.
Mm-hmm. And Ken, just to clarify, I was referring, I believe, to the existing reservoir. I think there's a city-owned field above the fire station on Orchard Heights, which probably has much more potential. But that's also a question for the engineers.
Exactly. That was the property I was thinking of. It's a future reservoir site that's being managed as Noak Savannah right now.
Yeah, I think that has a lot more potential. I think you're right.
All right. We have another more of a comment from Kirsten in the chat. She says her biggest concern and what she's noticed most over the last 15 years is the erosion, and that the bank seems more unstable. Thank you. That's a good feedback that you've been seeing this occurring over 15 years. Richard asks, how will this be paid for? Brian, I'll send that to you. Just kidding. Ben?
Yeah. So right now, this study and the plan for future improvements are, the plan is to fund them. The city will fund them out of our stormwater utility fund. So if you notice on your water sewer bill, the past several years, there's been a stormwater surcharge that folks have paid. And that goes to fund improvements to our stormwater system, such as this. So right now we are planning to fund this out of the utility rate funding.
Thank you, Ben. Linda has a question, wondering about future Goldcrest Brooks. Currently, we are watching lack of recognition and protection for a high gradient stream very similar to Goldcrest Brook. Does the city recognize the need to plan ahead?
Yeah, I can talk a little bit about that. So, yeah, you know, I think over the years, we've certainly learned about our stormwater design standards, and that continues to be an evolving issue. So, you know, for example, detention standards in the past, when much of Goldcrest Brooks were much less stringent than detention and stormwater treatment and encouraging of infiltration is now. And I expect that's going to continue into the future. So there's a major stormwater code revision done, oh geez, I'm thinking around 2015, that totally changed kind of the level of detention required, the level of water quality treatment and water and detention involved when we're doing things like adding impervious area. And so, yeah, I certainly, as we've developed along these kind of urbanized streams, we've learned more as we've moved forward, and our you know, response to that continues to evolve in regards to trying to protect these areas, prevent these sorts of situations from happening in the future. But, you know, it's a continuing process.
Thank you, Ben. And Ken asks, is there any order of magnitude estimate for the costs associated with this remediation?
No, I do not have one. So it's gonna really largely depend on, you know, some of the reasons, you know, one of the goals of coming out of this implementation plan is to essentially have that, to have a list of projects and cost estimates associated with those projects. Now, what we do have is we have a pot of money to go forward with some design, permitting, and implementation of some small improvements next year, and that's $100,000 right now, which is not a great deal considering the magnitude of the issues out here, but it'll get us started. And while we get the funding prioritized within the CIP to continue on with some of the larger, potentially more expensive improvements, but you know, evaluating that cost is a significant part of this effort as well that I really haven't mentioned. And that's really critical to moving those projects forward as well.
And I think too, you know, what I'll add is the potential improvements we're looking at really run a gamut, or really a broad spectrum of costs. Some of these improvements are relatively low cost. Some of them are much more intensive capital improvement project type costs. But we're trying to make sure that we're hitting a lot of places along that continuum of cost So we've got a real flexible toolkit.
So I presume that the result would be a series of options that have costs associated with them and choices could be made among them.
That's correct, yeah.
Richard asks, should we expect bigger surcharges then?
Not directly related to this project. So whether the stormwater surcharge will increase in the future, I couldn't say, but these types of projects generally don't have a direct impact to the rates the rate payers are paying across the city. We are, you know, those rates provide a certain amount of capital funding every year. And what we do is prioritize that capital funding amongst the projects. And our hope is that out of this implementation plan, it gives us a really good basis for getting money allocated towards these projects within our capital planning process.
Thank you, Ben. All right, I don't see any new questions. Kirsten did sign off, but she said she would be open to accessing the creek through her property if needed. So thank you, that's great. You know, we haven't heard a lot about what outcomes folks hope to see from this project. You know, we certainly are hearing addressing the erosion and protecting property, but are there any other outcomes folks are thinking about that they'd like to see from this project? That would be a good thing to get a little more information on. Don't see anybody offering thoughts on that. Okay.
Linda has her hand up.
Sorry, Rose, who has their hand up?
Linda does.
Oh, Linda, please unmute yourself. Go ahead.
So outcomes, I think the native vegetation, stabilizing the creek channel, leaving room for the creek to move, increasing habitat, improving the water quality, lowering the temperature of the water, just all those things sounded really good. I appreciate your study and your work. It's a noble effort. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. That's great. And I appreciate your holistic vision for what this corridor could be. We want to try to hit multiple objectives here and not just stop the erosion. You could do that with a bunch of rock, but that might not be permittable and it would not be good for the other creatures that use the creek corridor.
I agree with Linda and also with what EM put in the chat. I think we could maybe learn a lesson here for how to avoid this kind of situation in other creeks.
Great, thank you, Sarah. And EM in the chat says that they're looking for equilibrium and stability of the creek.
Absolutely, Steve, and I would ditto the broad spectrum that Linda offered verbally.
Excellent, thank you.
Linda has her hand up again.
Linda, go ahead, please.
Okay, sorry, I think I'm monopolizing this, but no. But I don't think when they did the fish study, I don't think they found any fish at Goldcrest Brook. In Goldcrest Brook, they did. I didn't remember that. Anyway, it seemed to me like there might have been a barrier where Goldcrest Brook goes into Glen Creek. And I know that there are beavers that work that reach too. So maybe getting some beavers up there. And if you improve the habitat that much, you might be able to have fish again. I mean, there's just a lot of good things that will happen if you can go ahead.
Yeah, cutthroat trout in 99.
Okay. Ken says they did find cutthroat trout in 99.
Crayfish.
and crayfish. Okay, then.
That's really neat. Really neat.
Thanks, Linda. I did. There is what appears to be a fish passage barrier on Harrit Drive, right at the confluence with Glen Creek. And in talking with one of the homeowners down there, he had mentioned that I think that he found a cutthroat years back. I don't think he gave a firm timeline, and he scooped it up in a pot and threw it into Glen Creek.
Well, let's hope it lived.
Yeah, yeah. But I appreciate your input. I do think that improving the habitat, it should be of concern.
Yeah, and I would agree that, you know, from what I saw at the confluence down there at Harrit, that seems to be a barrier too. It's a pretty significant drop off. And I think there's another drop off, another pretty significant head cut that's probably a barrier that's downstream of Linwood, between Linwood and Harrit too.
Great. All right, any other questions that folks have for the city or for ESA? If not, we'll give it just a couple minutes here, but if not, I think we can, we'll talk about the next steps and we'll wrap up the meeting a little bit early. Sarah, you turned your camera back on. Do you have a question?
Not a question, I guess, more of a comment. Twice in the last year or two, the city's offered free native plants that could be planted along the brook, and I've neglected to capitalize on that either time. I don't know if just laziness and scheduling, but like delivery or like a local sort of drop off, maybe in West, would be more efficient versus having to like go to the public works, or I think one was at like a nursery on 12th Street maybe. But anyway, just a suggestion that could be, the plants could be brought to West. That bridge is a psychological barrier that is difficult to, you know, to break.
Thank you. That's a great suggestion. You know, potentially I could see, you know, some kind of a volunteer native plant weekend event. And you're right, if the logistics are easy. I know from my own experience, it's hard to find native plants. You go pick them up and bring them home, and it takes a lot of time. But if there were already in the neighborhood and just needed folks to help put them in the ground, that's a great suggestion.
Sarah, I also appreciate that comment. That program is administered within our department, so we will take that suggestion to heart.
I love the free plants. That's awesome.
Great.
Steve Anderson has his hand up.
Just quickly, I'm in the land use chair with the Neighborhood Association. We've worked a lot with Ace Hardweather, and we'd be helpful to help to support that. And I think we could get the owners at Ace to be able to, you know, provide space for that for the city and that distribution. And so, you know, just check in with us if that's something you want to do. We've got a couple of businesses like Ace that would more than happy put that on their property, and Ace has places for that. So there's that relationship in the community that would more than happy to work with you.
Thank That's great, Steve. Thank you.
I know we moved it to a more central location last year to help with people, and we put it in an actual nursery so people could get there at different hours, but we can look into maybe having different nurseries, because that was one of the things that we've been talking about, was how to reduce the barriers for people to go and pick up those plants.
Excellent. Okay, any other final questions from folks? We got plenty of time, so if there's anything on your mind. Otherwise, I'm gonna start sharing my screen and just talk about the next steps real briefly, and we'll wrap things up a little bit early.
There was some questions in the chat.
Oh, yes, here we go. Thank you, appreciate that, Rose. Let's see, Linda wants to know if we will make a copy of the presentation available. And I believe this is being recorded. So Ben, can you speak to that?
Yeah, and I'm sure we can. I'm going to ask Deborah or Rose if we have a means to follow up with folks with a link to that, perhaps. Is that something you can do, Deborah?
Yeah, I have everyone's email address. And for those people who didn't attend, I was hoping to be able to share the link with the presentation as well. So we just have to get that on our end, and I'll go ahead and email it out once we get the place on YouTube or wherever it's going to be located.
Okay, thank you, Deborah.
Right. Richard has a nice comment. He thanked us for a comprehensive and informative presentation. So thank you, Richard. We appreciate that. Glad you enjoyed it and glad that you made the time to be part of this. And then Ken said that the city has a contract with Friends of Trees that could be used for a planting event. And he said, thank you very much for your work. That's another great idea, Friends of Trees. The corridor was cleaned up a little bit and ready for new vegetation. Sounds like we've got some really neat opportunities to get some of the right plants into that corridor. Okay. Let's see here. I'm gonna share my screen briefly again. And the next steps and a little bit of a timeline. So we are working on completing the feasibility study this summer. With that finished, we'll go ahead and be developing a draft remediation plan in the fall of this year. We'll share that with all of you. And then we'll have another workshop where we'll come back together to talk about the draft remediation plan, see what you liked about it, what you don't like about it, what kind of questions you have. And that will inform us to make some edits and then finalize the remediation plan. And the goal is to have that finalized by the end of this year. So we're calling it early winter 2021. So hopefully wrap up this phase of the project by the end of the year. All right.
All right, can I ask a quick question to follow up?
Yes.
Earlier you mentioned rain gardens as an option to help slow the water and reduce the water to getting into the streams. Are you going to be looking at specific areas or specific properties for that? Or are you kind of thinking about that just as a general concept for the areas? And I'm just wondering, because that might be a nice thing for the Watershed Council to get involved with us, because there's a lot of folks on the Watershed Council here with us tonight.
Brian, would you like to speak to that?
Yeah, I think that, you know, what we would look at in the feasibility study is, you know, getting a sense, making some estimates of, you know, how many downspouts, you know, we'll look at a range of, you know, how many rooftops might we be able to use this with. We're going to kind of work with the city and make sure that, you know, the approaches we're using for rain gardens are consistent with how they want to manage stormwater. We'll have to be flexible because we don't really know how many people would adopt them, but we might set some goals and you know, have come with an approach like if we could get 25 rain gardens, we might see this kind of benefit. If we could get 50 rain gardens, we might see this kind of benefit, you know, something like that to sort of bracket it. And so it'll go into the decision making. And it's like all, like many things, stormwater, you know, the more distributed and the more you can do, even if it seems like minor things, it all adds up. You know, that's how we get in these situations to begin with, because, you know, you cut down one tree and put in one sidewalk, no big deal. But at the point you've taken out a forest and you have 40% impervious, you now have big problems. So, you know, we would, you know, we're very curious to see sort of how much bang for the buck we could get from that practice. And until we go through a little bit more of the studies, we don't have any specific targets yet.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Oh, let's see. I see one more question from EM in the chat. How many residents actually sent water to Goldcrest? must be asking how many properties really contribute to Goldcrest.
Yes, that's correct.
Well, I don't have a specific number off the top of my head. I'm looking through the West report here to see, hold on, here it is. About 45 of the 49 houses that are right along the creek have rain spouts going directly into the creek.
My question was a little broader than that, Brian.
In the broadest sense, everybody who lives in the watershed is sending water to Goldcrest Creek.
Understood, and I was wondering how many rooftops and driveways that adds up to in terms of the total problem.
I don't think we have a firm number for that, EM. There are a significant number of properties there. We've created some animations showing when the impervious surface was installed throughout the years, but part of our analysis did not include how many houses are there. That is a number we could find out, but I don't know off the top of my head.
Yeah, and I'm looking back. I mean, 61% of the watershed is single family residential, but I don't have a specific number on, you know, we could look at that in acreage, but which puts you, you know, roughly 100 acres, of which, you know, trying to see how much of that would be rooftop. It's probably on the order of 50% of rooftop.
I'm really not asking for a number, but when you start going through putting models and scenarios together, part of that question is how many people need to do something differently, whether, as Ken suggested, have other collection points that will slow down the overall process. I'm just trying to get a sense. Deborah asked the question, how many rain gardens would have an impact? And it was in that context that I raised the question.
Yeah, and one thing I would say to think about too is, you know, those rain gardens might have a lot bigger impact along the creek than, for the folks upstream in the watershed, where we have the ability potentially to intercept that flow and detain it from a, you know, a larger group of those properties. So we have more management and control abilities oftentimes for the upstream folks than the folks with the gutter downspout pointed right at the creek. So that would probably that'll certainly be part of our analysis of, as we're looking at these rain garden options of, you know, getting the most bang for our buck versus maybe some larger control that might be able to handle a big group of those upstream properties.
Yeah, and that kind of speaks to like the reliability of how consistently you'll get a benefit from something. You know, you could, if everybody could build a rain garden this year, let's say, but if over time people don't take care of them and they fill in, somebody else moves in and they decide they want to do something else there, you know, you could lose function. So that's where it has to be considered, just sort of, you know, when you go from things happening within the public right away to more on private property, it's more of a voluntary thing. And like Ben said, the city would have less ability to sort of make sure things are performing to their maximum ability.
All right. Well, I don't see any more questions in the chat. Ben, what do you think? It's just about almost 8 o'clock. We wrap up a little bit early.
Yeah, I really appreciate everyone taking their time tonight. And I think the feedback we've gotten is great. I appreciate the questions. And I'll go ahead and actually, Deborah, you're going to be emailing the folks here with a link to the video, correct?
Yes, I'll be doing that in the next couple of days as soon as we get
and
it up.
Could you go ahead and pass on my contact information to the folks in case they have any other feedback or questions that come up that you just didn't think of at this time that we can get addressed or take into consideration?
Yep, I can do that.
I appreciate it. So thank you, everybody.
Deborah, I think if you could include our contact information as well, I think that would be great. At least speaking for all the other city staff, I'd be happy to take any questions.
I can CC you all on that email too, so everyone's contact will be readily available.
Great. I can always forward them to Ben too.
Yep.
Well, thank you so much, everyone. We really appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Have a good night.
Bye.
Bye.